Hello and welcome to Set Theory, a bite-sized lecture series. In these videos, you'll get a conceptual overview of set theory that doesn't take all day. If you're new to this channel, be sure to check out the playlist with all the videos in this series, which I'll link to in a card in the corner of the screen. And I still need to figure out what's going on with the cards, so those may not show up until a little bit later. This week, we're going to talk about one of the most important topics in set theory, cardinality. Cardinality is just another way of saying the size of a set, how many elements are inside it. We use cardinality primarily to talk about the size of finite or countably infinite sets, whereas uncountably infinite sets will deal more with something called ordinals. We will define finite and countable sets in this video and uncountable sets and ordinals in a few weeks. So why is cardinality important? Well, the answer isn't all that complex. It's just another part of building all the functions of math starting with only sets. And it's actually quite intuitive, so much so that when we first learn how to count, we are using cardinality without even realizing it. We don't start by teaching little kids about the concepts of the numbers 1, 2, and 3. We give them some apples or whatever, and we teach them, this group has one apple, this group has two apples, this group has three apples. And that's essentially the difference between numbers in algebra and cardinals in set theory. In set theory, we want to be able to express everything in terms of stuff and groups of stuff. So instead of just accepting the number 3, we want to define the number 3 as the size of a set with 3 things in it, which is something much easier to conceptualize. In order to define cardinality, we must first understand something called equinumerosity. That's a really fancy way of saying two sets are the same size as each other. I'll start with a charming little example given by Herbert B. Enderton. Imagine that your mathematical education is just beginning, that you are on your way to nursery school, which is a thing they called preschool, I think, when this book was written. You are apprehensive about going because you have heard that they have mathematics lessons and you cannot count past 3. Sure enough, on the very first day, they show you this figure and they ask, are there exactly as many houses as people? Your heart sinks. There are too many houses and too many people for you to count. But wait, all is not lost. You take your crayon and start pairing people with houses. You soon discover that there are indeed exactly as many houses as people, and you did not have to count past 3. You get a gold star and go home happy. Since we are not toddlers, and we have already learned lots of set theory, we will define equinumerosity as such. A set A is equinumerous to a set B if and only if there is a one-on-one correspondence between A and B. You can click on the card above to rewatch lesson 5 about functions, but for a brief recap, this means there is some function pairing up elements in A and B, such that every element in A has a distinct partner in B, and every element in B has a distinct partner in A. Which, as per our anecdote, makes perfect sense. If you can perfectly pair up the elements of A and the elements of B, A and B should be the same size. There are a bunch of examples of these kinds of equinumerosities in the sample problems, which I've linked in the description below. Now, we can finally formally define what it means for a set to be finite. A set is finite if and only if it is equinumerous to some natural number. Otherwise, it is infinite. For a refresher on the natural numbers, click on the card to watch lesson 6, or recall that we have defined each natural number as the set of all the natural numbers before it. For example, 3 equals a set of 0, 1, and 2. Now we see one huge reason why this definition of natural numbers is useful. If 3 is a set of 0, 1, and 2, then the cardinality or size of the natural number 3 is simply 3. In fact, for every natural number n, the cardinality of n is simply n. I acknowledge this is a little bit confusing because n now refers to multiple different things, but unfortunately that's just the way it's done, and I do believe that in the long run it avoids certain other kinds of confusion. We now extend this to define the cardinality of a finite set A, written as card A. As we might expect, card A is a cardinality of the natural number that A is equinumerous to. We can extend this definition further to say that for any sets A and B, finite or infinite, card A is equal to card B if and only if A is equinumerous to B. At this point, you might be thinking, wow, that was a lot of work to figure out something we already knew, but it's useful to have the formal definition so that we can escape the limits of our intuition and generalize these rules to all sorts of things we can't even imagine. It also lets us prove things that might not be so obvious. One last definition is the definition of a countably infinite set. Recall n, the set of natural numbers. From now on, we're going to call n omega, because starting in a couple weeks, we'll want to treat n, or omega, as essentially a number, just an infinite one. But we don't need to worry about that right now. All we need to know is that omega is now the set of natural numbers. In that case, we define the size of the natural numbers to be this weird symbol. This is the Hebrew letter aleph, so card omega equals aleph naught. And there is such a thing as aleph 1, aleph 2, forever and ever, which we will talk about in later videos. A countably infinite, or countable, set, therefore, is defined as a set that is equinumerous to omega, the set of natural numbers. The idea behind this is that if a set is countable, we can list out the terms in a certain order, 0, 1, 2, even if it would take forever to list them all. If you recall last week's video, the integers and the rationals were equinumerous to the natural numbers, so they are both countable, but the reals are not. This last part about the reals is called Cantor's theorem, and there's a really good video about its proof, Cantor's diagonal proof, that is linked in the example problems that I will also link in a card and in the description. Since all countable sets are equinumerous to the natural numbers, that means all countable sets are in fact the same size, something we showed in lesson 6. Also note that I am using the words countable and countably infinite interchangeably for expediency, but sometimes the word countable on its own means either finite or countably infinite, just not uncountable, so just be careful about that. The very last thing I'm going to do in this video is list 3 rules of cardinal arithmetic. These rules apply to any cardinal numbers, finite or infinite. Let's say that kappa is the cardinality of the set K, and lambda is the cardinality of the set L. So first, rule 1. Kappa plus lambda equals the cardinality of K union L, where K and L are disjoint sets. This rule says the size of two sets combined is the sum of their individual sizes. It's very important that K and L are disjoint, that is, they don't overlap, because if they do overlap, we have counted the overlap twice and we have to subtract the cardinality of K intersect L. Rule 2, kappa times lambda equals the cardinality of K times L, where K times L is the Cartesian product of K and L. Click on the card above to watch lesson 4 for a refresher on the Cartesian product. This is basically the formula for the area of a rectangle. If we have one set along the x-axis and one set along the y-axis, the size of the rectangle they form is the product of their two sizes. And rule 3. Kappa to the power of lambda equals the cardinality of K pre L, where K pre L is the set of all functions from L into, but not necessarily onto, K. One way to think about this is that we have our set L. We know we have to match every element in L with some element in K, and we want to figure out how many ways there are to do that. We'll pick some random element in L. For that element, we can pick anything in K to pair it with. That's kappa options. Now pick another element in L. Again, we can pick anything in K to pair it with, because the function doesn't have to be one-to-one, it just has to be well-defined, meaning that each element in L has to have some element in K that it maps to. For each of the lambda elements in L, there are kappa elements in K we could choose to pair it with. So the total number of functions from L into K, or the cardinality of K pre-L, is kappa times kappa times kappa multiplied lambda times once for each element in L, or kappa to the power of lambda. And that concludes the 8th video of this video series about set theory. I hope you enjoyed it, let me know what you think, and if there's anything that would make it better. Thanks for watching, see you next week.